It's a great pleasure and great honor to be here in a place dedicated to such a great teacher. And I want to talk about how Buddhadāsa has been a kind of inspiration and model for my own thinking about Buddhists. So I should make it clear that I'm not an expert on Ajahn Buddhadasa's thinking, thought. I never met the Ajahn, and I have read about him. I have read some of his book, but I have no claim to be an expert, nor am I going to here to explain what his ideas are. What the purpose, the talk is really about my own thinking about Buddhism and how Ajahn Buddhadasa has been a model for me. So what I will say just comes from me. I am absolutely not claiming the authority of Ajahn Buddhadasa. I'm just trying to think about what kind of forms of can Buddhism take in a modern society. This is actually one of my interest in being in Thailand, because there aren't so many modern Buddhist countries, and Thailand is kind of the only real Buddhist country that is modern or in the process of modernizing. And so this is, in general, this is an interest of mine, to think about what happens to Buddhism when society modernizes like it does in Thailand. Here, what I want to talk about is more about the Buddhist thoughts and how Ajahn Buddhadasa can be a model for thinking about Buddhism in a modern way. This is my own interest. Now, I have deep respect for Buddhist tradition, and many people are perfectly satisfied with traditional Buddhism, traditional Buddhist thought, and there is nothing wrong with that. My own approach is different. I tend to think that Buddhism, I want to think about Buddhism in relation to the modern world and in relation to other systems of thought. And so that's my own personal interest. I also think that this interest is of relevance to contemporary, maybe Thai Buddhist, because I think there are many beautiful aspects to Thai Buddhist, but I think I perceive, at least, I'm not sure whether I'm right or not, that there is a danger for Buddhists to remain just this kind of traditional culture which is irrelevant for modern Thais. And I think that's a real danger. At least this is how I perceive. Thais in this audience may tell me whether my perception is right or wrong, but I perceive this to be a real danger of Buddhism becoming this kind of traditional culture and something you see in the museum or you go to see in the temple, rather than something that people implement in their own life. And I think many monks have been concerned with that. And I think Ajahn Buddhadasa provide a good model of that. And that's what I want to talk about today, not an authoritative explanation of Ajahn's thought, but just my own thought about Buddhism in the light of Ajahn Buddhadasa's inspiration. So let me say a few words where I'm coming from. I am, as you can see, I'm not Thai. I am Swiss, actually. And when I was about 20 years old, I had to make difficult choices to decide what I wanted to do in life, and I really didn't know what to do. And so I took my backpack and hitchhiked to Asia and to India, where I met Buddhism in the form of Tibetan Buddhism. So I say that because what is interest to me is not so much Tibetan Buddhism per se, but Buddhism as such. That has always been my interest. And so it just happens I met Buddhism through Tibetan Buddhism. And so I spent many years in Dharamsala and in South India as a Buddhist monk, following the traditional curriculum of Tibetan monastic universities. And this is laid out in the book that Paco had the kindness to mention. So my background is very rationalist and very scientific. I was raised by a father who thought that I should become a physicist, and if I failed to become a physicist, I could be a doctor, but that was like the lowest acceptable point. Everything else was way below that and was not acceptable. So I was raised in a very scientific environment by a very, very smart, very kind, very wonderful father who taught me a lot of things and taught me precisely this scientific mentality. And so I'm very comfortable in a scientific environment. And so this is where I'm coming from. And so when I encountered Buddhism, I encountered a tradition that I was very skeptical of being interested in, because, you know, it's Buddhism and they have all these strange beliefs, and I was not particularly interested in that. But I discovered to my surprise that actually Buddhism was relevant to me. So what my idea of Buddhism is just very plainly dukkha and the end of dukkha. That's what Buddhism is for me. That's why I say I'm interested in Buddhism, not in Tibetan Buddhism, because for me, that's, and probably everybody will agree, that's the essence of Buddhism, right? It's the fact that life is besieged by suffering, and that we try to escape suffering, but that we are constantly struggling with suffering, and that therefore, if we want to use fully our human life, it would be good if we could develop some practice and some attitudes to deal with this fundamental problem of human life. And so that's what Buddhism is for me. It's almost, I would say, a kind of existential philosophy. As a teenager, I was very interested by existentialism. And so for me, Buddhism became a kind of a better version of existentialism, because existentialism just leaves you in despair, right? You're a human being, you have no idea why you're living, and then you have to die. Okay, that's not fun. But can we do something a little bit more positive? And that's my understanding of Buddhism, that we can do something much more positive about our human life. And that's what Buddhism is for me. Basically, the Four Noble Truths. So, you know, that's standard Buddhism teaching, and I encountered this teaching through a very a great teacher, Geshe Rabten, who was my first teacher in Dharamsala, who basically explained me the basics of Buddhism, the Four Noble Truths. Now, if Buddhism was always only the Four Noble Truths, we would not need to talk very much about Ajahn Buddhadasa as an inspiration. The reason Ajahn Buddhadasa was an inspiration is that Buddhism is not only Four Noble Truths. It comes with a traditional mythology, worldview, metaphysics, and so on, right? Now, for some people, it's totally okay. I lived many times before. I am going to be reincarnated. Maybe I will be reincarnated in hell. Hopefully not. Okay, that's a kind of metaphysic and worldview that is a traditional worldview. That's not my way of looking at the world, and that was always for me a big problem. And so this was the challenge. What do you do with all these traditional, these other aspects of Buddhism that seems to my own mentality seem quite difficult to accept. So when I became a monk, I had to learn Tibetan, and then I was trained on the basis of a type of literature which is called the Stages of the Path in Tibetan Lamrim, which is a wonderful text, but it has a lot of these traditional aspects of Buddhism. And I remember a particular lesson of my teacher in which there was somebody who had done something really bad, I forgot what, sorry, and he was reincarnated with having 500 heads. And I thought, okay, I may be able to accept reincarnation, but 500 heads, that I have a problem. So it's this kind of problem that I encountered in my training as a young monk. I was living in a Tibetan monastery. My second teacher, Geshe Latir Mpoche, was a very strict teacher, a very learned and very accomplished teacher, but extremely strict and extremely traditional. And so I got spared nothing, including debate on why the earth was not round and so on. So I was really exposed to Tibetan Buddhism and to Buddhism in its most traditional and conservative form. So I was kind of, full of goodwill and willing to put up with these things, but I was obviously not very convinced. And so this is when I encounter the pamphlets of Ajahn Buddhadasa, and this was a real breath of fresh air, because these pamphlets were saying, well, look, there is traditional Buddhism, but maybe we don't need to think about Buddhism in this traditional form. Maybe we don't need to think so much about past and future lives and can think about Buddhism in a different way. And this was coming from somebody very learned, very accomplished, a real master of Buddhism. And so I thought, well, if he thinks that, maybe I can start to think on my own a little bit. And then I was lucky enough to be advised by the Dalai Lama, who encouraged me. In fact, at one point I went to see him and he told me, you're creating a lot of trouble in my monastery. I was staying in his monastery, because you are always asking monk questions about karma and reincarnation, and they don't know what to answer. And so they are really getting annoyed. And so I was kind of wondering whether he was scolding me, but he ended by saying, and you should continue, this is very good. And so this is, basically, I got the message that Buddhism was not just this set of traditional beliefs and ideas, but this was a living tradition in which people were not just allowed, but encouraged to think for themselves. And so now thinking for oneself in a tradition is not so easy, and this is what I learned through the many years of my training. But this was an incredible breath of fresh air when I was confronted with these traditional ideas and beliefs, about which I have nothing bad to say. There is nothing wrong with them. It's just a question whether they fit oneself or not. And what I think is ridiculous is to try to force one's mind in a particular mindset. That's not for me what Buddhism is. Buddhism is for me to be free, and to be free to think rather than to be corseted in set ideas. And so this is why Ajahn Buddhadasa was so inspiring for me. Later on, when I learned more the scholastic background of the Tibetan tradition, I realized that this is a long tradition in Buddhism, that in Indian Buddhists there was this long tradition of inquiry. There was centuries of debate between Buddhists and Hindus, using basically philosophy and logic to argue and not at all believe based on scripture and so on. And so there is this tradition of free inquiry in Buddhism. And I think as modern Buddhists, I want to use this tradition of free inquiry. And so this is why Ajahn Buddhadasa has always been a model. So one of the most radical idea of Ajahn Buddhadasa is his downplaying of the teaching of reincarnation, past and future lives. I think it's an interesting idea, and I think it's interesting to try to understand what is Buddhism, what could Buddhism look like if it is not based on past and future lives. And that's what I want to talk a little bit. As you know, if you're a Westerner, if you're Thai, you probably don't know, but if you're a Westerner, this is a big debate among Western Buddhists for a long time. There was a famous Bob Sermon against Stephen Batchelor debate in the review Tricycle. And so this is obviously an important topic for Westerners, because as Westerners, the idea of past and future life is pretty alien to us. And it's also an idea which is in some tension with a kind of scientific worldview. So how I perceive Ajahn Buddhadasa's position is something that I find of value, because he's, in my own perception, he's trying to think about a modern form of Buddhism while at the same time making sure that Buddhism does not become assimilated to a kind of, you know, modern idea. So for me, for example, a person like Stephen Batchelor, or what people call secular Buddhism in America, I don't know if you're familiar with that, is an attempt to make Buddhism completely secular, and so you end up talking about race, gender, and all these things. Now, there is nothing wrong to talk about race and gender. I'm perfectly happy to talk about that. That's obviously an important part of human condition, but I don't think that's what Buddhism is really about. And I think Ajahn Buddhadasa presents us a form of Buddhism which keeps the essential of what Buddhism is about, which is dukkha and the end of dukkha, so dukkha and nirvana, and does not just reduce Buddhism to a kind of good ethical system as understood by the modern world. And I think that's where a lot of Western Buddhists tend to go too far in wanting to make Buddhism into basically a form of liberal ideology, modern contemporary liberal ideology. And believe me, I am a progressive person, and I am all for being liberal and progressive. So it's not that I have an objection against this philosophy, against these ideas per se, but I don't think that's what Buddhism is about. And I think Ajahn Buddhadasa, in a way, presents us a kind of middle way between a completely traditional form of Buddhism and a completely secularized form of Buddhism, as my good friend Stephen Batchelor and others are trying to do. So, now, I also want to make very clear that in saying that we can have a Buddhism that does not rely on the idea of past and future life, I am not saying that this is what the Buddha taught. In the Pali Canon, the Buddha is presented in many, many, many suttas as talking about past and future lives, as talking about nirvana, as the end of reincarnation. And so there is no question that this is completely present in the Pali Canon. Now, personally, I will never to say this is what the Buddha taught or didn't teach, because I think for historical reason, it's quite hard to know exactly what the Buddha taught. But we have the Pali Canon, we have the Chinese Agama, which are probably 4 or 5 centuries removed from the Buddha, and this is the closest we can get to the Buddha's teachings. So when we look at this canonical material, there is no question that there are teachings about reincarnation, about hell, about heaven, and all these different aspects of traditional Buddhism. So my claim here is not at all that this is not part of Buddhism. It is part of Buddhism. This is what I would call traditional Buddhism. My claim here is that we can have a form of Buddhism that does not rely on that kind of worldview, that is rely much more on a modern worldview, while at the same time preserving the idea that Buddhism is not just a kind of liberal ethical philosophy, but is also about transcendence, the transcendence of nirvana, right? So this is what I find in Buddhadāsa, a very strong emphasis on the importance of nirvana, the importance of experiencing nirvana, while at the same time not relying on this traditional model of reincarnation. Because conceptually, at least, there is no reason to... I mean, nirvana does not rely on the existence of reincarnation. It is presented in the sutta, in many suttas, as the end of reincarnation. But conceptually, it does not rely on the on reincarnation. Nirvana is the eradication, the complete eradication of all the klesha, negative emotions. So this eradication of the klesha can be experienced in this life by people who are dedicated enough to practice, and we don't need to presuppose reincarnation. We also don't need, in my own mind, it's not that I exclude reincarnation, it's just that reincarnation doesn't really play a very large role, because that's not how my worldview is. And so I want to find a Buddhism that is true enough to Buddhism, but that at the same time is in accordance with this modern worldview. Now, if we don't have reincarnation, we could ask, how much of Buddhism has changed? And the answer is, in certain ways, a lot. In certain other ways, not very much. So, a lot, because when we read the sutta, when we read Buddhist teaching, they all couch in this very traditional worldview, in which we talk about karma, reincarnation, and being reborn in hell or in animal or in God realm, or hopefully as human. And this is how Buddhism is presented traditionally. Now, if we were to bypass this traditional worldview, you would ask, what are we left with? And the answer is, we're left with Buddhism pretty much as it has been. Not believing in reincarnation is not going to change very much. It's going to change some things, but not other things. It's going to change the metaphysical framework, But it's not necessarily going to change Buddhist practice. Because what is Buddhist practice? Well, there are many models, but probably the easiest, the one I always teach to my student, is Sila Samadhi Panya, morality, concentration, wisdom, right? This is the simplest articulation of the Buddhist path. And if we think about that, well, sure. So first Sila, karma is a very important teaching. And we, as Buddhists, I think we need to take it very seriously, because karma is a complicated doctrine that has many different aspects. Part of it is metaphysical, it's how the whole universe is organized. That one presupposes reincarnation, so without that one, you cannot have karma as a kind of metaphysical principle. Personally, I don't think it's such a great loss, but you might differ, and we can talk about that. Then there is karma as a moral doctrine, what you should do and not do, and how you should consider your actions, whether you should take responsibility of your actions and think about what you do and you don't do. That, I think, is extremely important. And it's extremely important, especially for us Westerners, because, or at least Westerners from the 60s, right? Because we think the world is our oyster and we can do anything we want, right? And maybe not. Maybe not. And then I think karma is also a very important doctrine psychologically, because karma is basically says that we are what we're doing. We might think ourselves as very good people, but if we're doing crappy things, we are crappy people, because the definition of crappy people is to do crappy things. There is nothing else besides crappy people, besides doing crappy things. In fact, people are neither crappy nor good, but basically we are defined by what we do, right? And we may think that we can escape the consequence of what we do, and, you know, I can cheat a little bit, and if nobody looks, that's not too bad. But really, the reality is that this is what makes us who we are, our actions. And that part of the doctrine of karma, for me, remains whether there is reincarnation or not. Doesn't make a whole lot of difference. If we want to be good people, we have to think about what we do, what we don't do, and how we treat other people, right? And that's just plain basic morality, and that's what the teaching of karma is concerned about. And then, obviously, if we want, we can also practice meditation, samadhi, panya, concentration, insight or wisdom. And so none of this fundamental Buddhist practice is going to be affected. So my claim is basically that for me, how I understand Buddhism is that it is about dukkha, that it is about eliminating dukkha, and that this fundamental teaching does not really rely on reincarnation. And so if we bypass that teaching, we can still have a full-fledged form of Buddhism. And that's what I find, this is the inspiration I find in Ajahn Buddhadasa, who always stressed that Buddhism is about nirvana, right? It's not just about being ethical or meditating, but it is about transcendence as well. And I think if we make Buddhism too secular, we're in danger of forgetting this transcendent dimension, right? So if we... Now, you may have an objection and say, if we don't believe in karma, in a reincarnation, why should we practice Buddhism, right? Many people make this kind of objection. And the answer is pretty simple. Now, nobody is obliged to practice Buddhism, right? But if you think that, if you pay attention to the human condition, if you pay attention to the fact that we are going to die and that this life is a constant struggle against change and trying to keep ourselves going in a world that is in constant changes, if you think that this is a relevant way of thinking about human life, I think Buddhism is relevant, despite, even if you are not interested in the teaching on reincarnation. It's a real interesting empirical question to know how much belief motivates people. The objection is, if you don't believe in reincarnation, you're not going to be motivated to practice strongly enough. And there might be some truth in it, because if you think you are in the literal infernal cycle of samsara, that might be a strong motivation to practice. So there may be some truth. But there is a question of what really motivates people to do what they do. And when I read the... I think you gave me the book on Luang Pocha. Yeah. If you see, his life is really interesting, because he becomes monk not so much because of reincarnation and samsara, but basically because he doesn't like worldly life and he wants to lead the life of a monk and wants to meditate. And that's his fundamental motivation. So I think most people are actually not so much motivated by what they believe, but mostly by attraction for certain things and lack of interest for some other things. In short, it's much more emotions than belief that I think push people to practice Buddhism. Now, maybe some people believe so strongly that it creates a strong emotion in them. I would certainly not exclude that. The Scottish, right, philosopher Hume, because now we're in Brexit and soon we might have a Scottish independence, so Scottish philosopher David Hume made the argument, very extreme argument, that what motivates people is only emotions and not belief at all. I'm not sure that I buy that, but I think I would tend to think that that beliefs play a role, but that what mostly attracts us are kind of emotions that we have in relation to life, problems in life, or to certain people we admire, because often for many people, they practice Buddhism because they met a person who they deeply admire and they want to imitate that person, and there is nothing wrong with that. So I don't think that if we adopt this form of Buddhism, we will lack the motivation to practice, because we are human beings, we have to die, and we are in this constant struggle with dukkha, and that's just the reality of human condition, regardless of what we believe or not. I am always... Now, things could be changing if transhumanists were to be right. I don't know if you heard about that. There are people who are thinking that we can download our consciousness on computers and so on. Obviously, I don't believe a word of that. But that preoccupation, the fact that people take refuge in such crazy idea, shows me the intensity and the intensity of the concern that people have for what Buddhism calls dukkha. And they think that downloading their mind in the computer is a way to overcome dukkha. I don't think it's going to work, but it shows that this is a human problem. And from my perspective, Buddhism offers realistic way to deal with this problem. Now, what are people going to do? Well, I think there are different models of Buddhist practice. I think there is, it would be a mistake to think of Buddhist practice only in as being one thing. And the Lamrim, where about the stages of the path literature, which is based on Atisha's teachings, have a very nice presentation of three scopes of Buddhist practice. And so I want to finish with that and then maybe hear what you have to say. The three scopes of Buddhist practice is the small scope is the good person in the world, the person who do good things and who leads an ethical life in the world. The second, this is a small scope. The second scope, the middle scope, is liberation for oneself, becoming an arhat. Now you may say, this is not so bad, right? Yeah, this is the middle scope. The great scope is the bodhisattva, the path of the person who helps others. And I think we can, obviously, many people don't like when there is this kind of ranking, 1, 2, 3, because especially as Westerners, we tend to be all egalitarian. But in a way, that doesn't matter. What matters is that there are these three models of a good Buddhist life. The bodhisattva, the person who helps others and who dedicates his or her life to helping others. And I think this is a totally amazing life and an incredibly valuable way of spending the few years one has. There is a person who wants to attain liberation, who practices meditation for the sake of attaining liberation in this life, who devotes months and years to practicing meditation and who really seeks to attain nirvana in this life. And then there is the people like me who are trying to do as well as possible. And these people, I think, I mean, obviously, I would never compare myself to a great arhat or a bodhisattva like the Dalai Lama, but I think leading a Buddhist life, meditating, keeping precepts, even if you don't attain nirvana, the ultimate nirvana in this life, is a great way to spend one's life. Very useful for oneself and very useful for other people as well. Ajahn Buddhadasa has this particular teaching which is interesting and quite controversial about the kind of, there is the ultimate nirvana and then there is the nirvana that you can experience in this life, right? And that I think is an interesting thing to think about the relation of people of Buddhist people to nirvana, because if you're not going to devote years and years to meditations, now you may be an extraordinarily gifted person, because there are people apparently who wake up in 5 minutes, they are in the scripture, they are there, and apparently it exists. I'm not like that. Maybe some of you might be. So if you, as a Buddhist, you're not interested in spending years and years and years of meditation, like I've met some of the meditators in the Tibetan tradition, they were like, they had 15, 20 years in isolation, and they were telling me, oh yeah, when are you going to be serious and join us? It's like, oh, this is not me. Unfortunately, this is not me. So, if we are not interested in spending years and years in retreat, we can still lead a very valuable Buddhist life and maybe have some experience of the ultimate, of nirvana, and this is, I think, a perfectly valuable way of leading one's life. When I met, I think it was second meeting with the Dalai Lama, he told me, well, you know, this is quite difficult and it takes a long time, but even if you do a little bit, it will be valuable. And I was 21 years old, so pretty stupid, and I thought, well, you're talking about yourself, because me, get ready, I'm going to go all the way to Nirvana. Well, I'm still here. Okay, thank you. Question, objection?
Yeah, so for all questions, objections, etc., we'll pass a microphone to you. If somebody can pass the microphone.
In case of the Tibetan Buddhism,
yeah.
I think this reincarnation is pretty much institutionalized,
yes,
into the society. And in case of maybe Theravadin tradition,
yeah,
I seldom heard, you know, this institutionalization, you know. Like in Myanmar, I met some monk that told me they have the technique to remember the past life.
I see.
You know, life after life, many yeah. lives, but they don't claim, you know,
yeah.
the reincarnation.
Yeah.
Why, you know, the...
Okay, it's a bit of a long story, but it's easy to understand why. The idea of reincarnation is widespread in both Tibetan and Theravada cultures. It's exactly the same, no difference. What is difference is the institutional recognition, right? So the question is why Tibetan adopted this institutional recognition. Now, it has to be said it's only for a few monks and teachers, right, whose reincarnation are sought. Now, why did this happen? Well, it happened for historical reason. The traditional model of a Buddhist society is a duality between king and sangha. And the sangha provides the ideological backbone to the king, but the king is in power and the king rules like kings do, often quite violently. That's a model, a traditional model that goes back to King Ashoka, right? Now, in Tibet, Buddhism arrived in the 8th century, end of the 8th century, beginning of the 9th century. It arrived before, but really developed in the second half of the 8th century, first half of the 9th century, under a similar model in which you had a strong monarch and you had the development of the Sangha and so on. After the middle of the 9th century, what we see happening in Tibet is a collapse of worldly king's authority and the dissolution of Tibet into a myriad of little principalities and little fiefs, right? Fiefdoms. And so this situation is going to last for several centuries. Some people call it the Dark Age of Tibetan Buddhism, of Tibet. And it's in a way never going to be, Tibet is in a way never going to be recovering from that. What is going to happen is that out of this political chaos, the more viable candidate for political power are going to be religious traditions. And so what you see in the 12th century, 13th century, is different religious traditions like the Sakya and the Kagyu getting into power and not being very successful, but being at least able to bring a kind of normality. Now, the Sakya lineage is an uncle-nephew lineage, So there is no problem. But if you look at the other Buddhist tradition, like the Kagyu and later the Gelugpa, the main teachers are all monks. And so monks don't have children. And so how are you going to ensure the continuation of your rule if you don't have offspring? Well, Buddhist metaphysics offers a wonderful recourse, which is reincarnation. You're not going to get... So you have the Karmapa, who is, for example, the second or third Karmapa. The third Karmapa, second and third Karmapa are important hierarchy in Tibet. And so when they pass away, what happens? Well, you need to find a way to stabilize the legitimacy of the holder, of the leader of the lineage, which is both a religious lineage and a political institution at the same time. How are you going to do it? Well, Tibetans chose reincarnation. And so this is why Tibetans developed this institution of reincarnated lama, in which people, teachers who pass away, they chose the reincarnation in order to bring them and have them assume the role that their predecessors were. So this is why Tibet developed this really strange institution. And what you see historically, as you can see, I'm not a big fan of this institution. I much prefer the traditional Buddhist model, which is king and sangha. I think it's a much better model for a Buddhist society. What you see is that the institution of reincarnated lama emerged something 12th century in Tibet. And what you see is from the 12th to probably 15th, 16th century, there are very few reincarnated lama. And then as times go by, there is a multiplication of reincarnated lama. At first, you maybe had 10, 20, then it gets to hundreds. Now it's in the thousands, right? Because every little monastery wants their own reincarnated lama because it brings them prestige, offerings, and so on. So it's important to understand that the Tulku institution is a social institution. It's a cultural, socio-cultural institution which has roots in Buddhism but is not... it's just an accident of history that Tibetans developed this kind of way to transmit legitimacy, right? That's what the institution of Tulku is about. Now, Tibetan Buddhism is a very complex tradition, so there is the added advantage that if you train children from a very young age, they will be able to master a phenomenal amount of teachings, for example, tantric empowerment. And so for this, Tulku is a really good system because you need children to be, you need many, many years to master all these practices. So this is another advantage of the Tulku institution. But basically, the Tulku institution is a historical accident. Yeah?
I forgot when Dalai Lama said this, but he said one time during the teaching, now there are many Tulkus, yeah, reincarnations,
yeah,
but we have to teach those kids really from the zero.
Yeah,
they sure. They can't remember anything. And no more Tulku, you know. That's what he mentioned. So that really not a real incarnation, but the like monasteries, small monasteries are creating, you know, the big guys. You know.
Yeah, the Dalai Lama is a very ambivalent relation to the Tulku system. When he was young, he was pretty much opposed to this system. Then Tibet reopened and Tibetans in Tibet wanted to continue the institution of Tulku, and so for them, tulkus were a personality around which they could gather, a personality they could rely on, and so on. And so in Tibet, the tulku system got reinvigorated after the Cultural Revolution. And so the Dalai Lama kind of changed some of his idea, but he's always been pretty skeptical about this system. It's also fair to say that in Tibetan Buddhism, the high, what they call high lamas, who are the head of a lineage, are chosen very carefully. Most of the other tulku are chosen pretty, not very carefully. I remember Trichan Rinpoche's, who is the tutor, one of the tutors of the Dalai Lama, who said, when they present me three candidates, I just throw dices and one, and I try to look to the one who is the most intelligent, and that's the one I choose. Which is not a very rigorous way of choosing. But it is true that Tibet has managed to produce these wonderful great lamas who have impressed the world. You know, the way Tibet dealt with its political chaos is basically by relying on foreign power, mostly Mongols and Chinese. And so the way they did it is basically by having these great lamas going to see the Khan or the emperor and impressing them. And the Khan or the emperor being totally becoming their students and their disciple. And so this was the way that the Tibetan hierarchy dealt with this political situation, by gaining the support of external power, different tribes of the Mongol or the Qing dynasty, for example. And this is how it worked. When you have Mao Zedong as your emperor, that's not so good, right? That's not going to work. But yeah. So, and the present Dalai Lama is an excellent example of an amazing personality who impressed a lot of people, right? And he's a total product of this tulku system, right? He was raised in the Potala from a very young age by his tutors. Must not have been fun to be him. Incredibly strict, and yeah. And he has become this great person, right?
Don't you think that on strictly Buddhist teachings themselves, you can reject rebirth? Buddhist teaching says everything is about non-permanence. Everything is impermanent. Non-self, and especially there is nothing that is independently arising. So on the, if nothing is independently arising, everything is dependently arising, i.e. I am, you are, we all, and everything is constantly a product of the ever-changing environment, then there cannot be possibly rebirth. It is scientifically, even on pure Buddhist science, in my opinion, impossible to believe in rebirth. It's just naive. I mean, any little leaf on a tree will die. That very same little leaf will not ever get reborn. It will be very slightly different.
Okay. I think you are going a little bit further than I would wish to go. I think your way, your logic is fine, but I think it's important to understand that Buddhist tradition is quite complex, and so there is not just one version of Buddhism, but there are many. For example, if you look at the Pali Canon, there are kind of strands of the teaching that are conflicting, right? So I kind of share, I mean, I understand your logic, but I think it would be really problematic to say that people who believe in reincarnation are not following properly the logic of Buddhism. I would never say that because I think Buddhism is multiple and there are people who want to have a traditional Buddhism, and that's perfectly 100% fine. And there are people like me who are like, well, reincarnated as an animal, that doesn't make too much sense. Let's try to think about Buddhism slightly differently. And I think it's important to understand the fact that there are multiple interpretations of Buddhism. And I think what is, you see, what I appreciate in Buddhadāsa is this freedom to interpret the teaching, but to understand that this is an interpretation and that maybe there are other ways to understand Buddhism, right? Because there are different ways. And personally, as a Westerner, I would never say to a Buddhist that you're naive in believing in reincarnation. You know, I'm a Farang, and I'm not part of a Buddhist culture. I learned Buddhism, and so I am totally respectful of the belief of the traditional belief and the traditional practices. But I want to find a Buddhist that works for me, and I think that's about as far as I would be ready to go, because I think there are different ways to think about Buddhism. There are different traditions and different ways to think about Buddhism, and your reasoning is certainly one reasoning, and it's a reasoning I'm relatively sympathetic, but it's not the only way to think about it. Now, obviously, as you know, the problem of no self and rebirth is a long-standing question in Buddhism. There are many different answers. I think the most standard answer is that there is a continuum and that continuum goes to another life. And that's a standard answer. There are other answers as well. So I think there are many different ways of thinking in Buddhism. And precisely as a modern person, I think we should use these possibilities. My way of thinking, because, you know, I'm a Geshe, so I spent years learning this tradition, and I have deep respect for this tradition. At the same time, I want to find something that works for me, and so this is the kind of middle way I'm looking for, because I don't want Buddhists to become just another form of Western progressist liberalism, however much I agree with this ethical stance. I want Buddhists to remain Buddhism and to be about something more than just leading an ethical life. And that's a kind of middle way that I find inspiration in Ajahn Buddhadasa, who always emphasize Nibbana, right? Nirvana.
I'd like to mention that Bhikkhu Bodhi mentions that Theravada Buddhism is sort of a hodgepodge of four different religions. At the bottom level, you have a real free-for-all of beliefs in spirits and ghosts and all kinds of creatures and superstitions. At the second level, you have a religion, something like Catholicism, which promises you that if you lead a good life and you donate to the temple, you will be blessed with a good reincarnation. Then there's the third level, which is the traditional teachings of the sutras, that if you follow the Four Noble Truths, morality, wisdom, and meditation, you will be freed from suffering. And then he mentions a fourth level, which again is another free-for-all, which is a level of the wise man, the guru, the holy man, the king, and the emperor, who is totally free from any tradition, any belief, and just carries on whatever he sees fit.
Do you want me to respond? Okay, I'm surprised that Bhikkhu Bodhi would mention the fourth category. The first three categories, I think we are all aware of that. I wouldn't use the term superstition because I think it's really a derogatory term and towards what is the culture of people, right? So I have no problem with people believing in ghosts. I don't, but, you know, if people want to believe in ghosts, or if people are born in a culture where they believe in ghosts, yeah, that's neither here nor there, right? This is just a culture. But, yeah, no, I think there is... Thai Buddhism is a complicated tradition, right? And there is this animistic aspect, and there is this other aspect of making merit and so on. So it is fair to say that you find these different aspects in all the Buddhist traditions. Tibetans have also all this animistic aspect. They have also all the merit making. This is all over the Buddhist world. This is not just in Thailand. I think it's interesting to, in a way, what I think is that the way I see Buddhist practice for lay people is trying to think about what would be a modern equivalent of doing what's called in Thai tambun, merit, like going to temple and so on. There is nothing wrong with that, and many people get great benefit from going to temple. But if you think in a modern society, what is the Buddhist equivalent? I think it's, you know, keeping precepts and doing some meditation, maybe doing some retreats and leading your life in this way. And that to me is a kind of Buddhist practice that strikes me as corresponding to the small scope that I mentioned in Atisha's foundational text. And I think it's important to think about, for me at least, Buddhism as not just being, there are the people who are meditating in a cave and everybody else is just schmucks and they are not real Buddhists and so on. That's not how I think about it. Obviously, people who are meditating for years are engaged in a wonderful, very valuable endeavor, and they are worth our admiration. But Buddhism is not just about that. Buddhism is also about normal people leading their life, and it's also about bodhisattvas helping people. So I think there is a vast array of Buddhist practice, and I think it's really useful to think about Buddhist practice as being not just one thing, but as being a large scope of possible activities.
I come from Denmark, and I have a lot of students. I'm an esports teacher, teaching them how to play computer games.
I'm trying to bring meditation into the practice, because it's helped myself a lot, overcoming anxiety and other stuff. And I've been finding Buddhism and meditation especially to be really helpful, like developing your mind and your sense of just being a more contributing person to society overall. I've been having some positive effects of teaching them guided meditation and body scan, but it's still very hard to get them to understand the like how good it actually is for meditation. So I would ask you, do you think it is even possible to teach young people meditation if they're resistant to it? Or could there be some other way to make them engaged in something that helps them clear their mind? Because they're very stressed out for various reasons.
Yeah, I think... computer games is the opposite of meditation. Because it's a form of attention that is completely object-driven, and this is 180 from meditation. Meditation is a form of attention which is not object-driven, right? And that's what one learns in meditation, is to pay attention, despite the fact that one deals with incredibly boring objects like one's breath or a casino or whatever. And the reason is that if you look at the screen and it's exciting, you're not learning how to modulate your own mind, right? You're not learning how you control your own attention. And it is this skill that is important in meditation and that is very important for leading a good life, right? Because if you don't learn how to modulate your own mind, you're going to be just follow any kind of impulse that's coming, and you have no way to control from what's coming from below, right? Because things are going to come from below all the time, and if you follow what comes from below all the time, you are going to be a slave. You're never going to be free, right? And so it's important. It's an incredibly important skill, I think, for people to learn how to modulate their own mind, right? To learn that what comes in your mind is not necessarily what you need to follow and what you need to do and what you need to be, to believe. It's just what came in your mind at a particular moment, and you have to find a way to detach yourself so as to be aware of what's going on and able to assess what's going on for you and whether this is the thing you, the path you really want to follow or not. So this skills, I think, is incredibly important, and this is what I teach to my students when I teach meditation. Now, if somebody is unwilling to practice meditation, I have no idea how you're going to force them or con them into doing meditation, but this is what I teach my students when we do meditation. I tell them, look, there is all these Buddhist ideas, but really, and if you want to become Buddhist, you're welcome, but really what we are here to learn is how you can learn how to pay attention to your own attention and your own mind, and learn how to modulate your own mind and direct your own mind in a more fruitful way. And that, I think, is a skill that everybody, every human being should have, right? But if you're addicted to computer games, I don't know what you do, because you're totally absorbed into the object, right? And so that's, yeah, I think that's where modern culture is really makes us. I think my students are actually quite different from me, because, you know, I grew up in a time, I don't know if you can imagine, there were no cell phone, no computers. It's hard to imagine, but when I was in India, I could not receive a phone call. I would have to go to Delhi, to 20 hours away to receive a phone call, or I would send a letter and get the letter back 3 weeks later, and so on. My students are used to everything happening in the moment, right? And yeah, so I think meditation is really important for precisely dealing with this kind of hyper-object-dependent culture, right? Where you're constantly looking for excitement outside by looking at screen and so on. Yeah, please.
Yeah, because I think they're really, my students, a lot of them who seek into computer games, and that I see they're incredibly smart, a lot of them, like high IQ and whatever other predicators you can use for intelligence. And it's very easy for them to make a fast logical conclusion, then all they need to do is play computer games, become world champion, and then their life is like, they can only see that far. It's really hard for them to make the connection that if I do meditation 5 minutes every night, it's going to have these consequences over time. So it's, do you think I need to make a really good presentation on making them understand the logical aspects of...
What I see in my students is this, like you say, this incredible smartness, but also this incredible fragility. And so that's, I think, where you can work on the fragility, because they're full of anxiety and so on. And so you can tell them, look, there are ways to deal with that. You don't need to be... And that's how I talk about addiction in my class on meditation, because addiction is a good model of how these things can go wrong for us if we don't pay attention to what happens in our minds, right? And so I think that's a way to work with them about anxiety and addiction and all these many problems that they have. Because my perception is that I could be wrong, but is that they're incredibly fragile compared to people like me, but even compared to people who are like now in their 40s.
Swadika Pachan.
Two questions. First question is, which aspects of Tibetan Buddhism has been most helpful to your practice?
Very good question.
And the second question, which is related, is I've read a bit about the great emptiness.
The what?
The great emptiness. Dzogchen? Is it pronounced as Dzogchen?
Oh, Dzogchen. Dzogchen. Okay.
Can you talk a little bit about that also and what it is?
Yeah, very different question. First question, I really like it because, I mean, it's not that I dislike the second, but... I really like it because I realize that my approach to Tibetan Buddhism is incredibly idiosyncratic, because Tibetan Buddhism has, if you want, three layers. It has the basic Buddhist teaching, same as Theravada. Then it has Mahayana, which has both new sutras and a lot of philosophy. And then it has Tantra. Now, in Tibetan practice, Tantra is incredibly important, but I am not interested. So I am very comfortable in Thailand, because what interests me is basically basic Buddhism. But, and this is why I'm different, is that also I think there is nothing wrong with the Theravada tradition, but it tends to be a kind of exclusive and narrow tradition. And I think it's a great advantage for Buddhists to understand the whole array of school and thinking and practices in the Buddhist tradition, because Theravada is certainly an important tradition and I value it enormously. But we have to be aware, this is not exactly how Buddhism was at the time of the Buddha. It developed gradually, it has a complicated history. So it is a tradition, but there are other Buddhist traditions, and so it's really valuable to look at other Buddhist traditions. So what do I take from Tibetan Buddhism? Well, there is this teaching of the Lamrim, which I think is incredibly useful, stages of the path literature, which teaches about the three scopes of Buddhist practice, which I think is a really useful model for Buddhist practice. But I also take all the philosophy, because Tibetan Buddhism got all the Indian Buddhist philosophy, which did not come through the Theravada tradition. The Theravada tradition basically seemed to have... If you look at Buddhist philosophy, development of Buddhism, what you see is first a period of about 2-3 centuries of debates about the canon, what is canonical, what is not, and what is in the Vinaya and what is not. And then from about the probably 2nd century BC, you start to see the beginning of Buddhist thinking, of Buddhist philosophy, trying to systematize the teaching. So, for example, you find this in the Milindapañña question of King Milinda and the Katavatu, where you start to see debates about meaning of karma and the scope of karma, and different debate about self and no self and reincarnation and so on. And this is basically where Theravada tradition seemed to stop. What happens in India, is around the 2nd century AD, you have this new development of Buddhist writing now not in Pali, but in Sanskrit, which is the language of the learned people, and writing about philosophical ideas in order to debate with the Hindus and the Jains. And so you have from the 2nd to the 10th century this incredible development of Buddhist philosophy. So you have Madhyamika, you have Yogacara, you have all the epistemology and the philosophy of mind that comes out of that. And that's what I am really interested in Tibetan Buddhism. So if you want, temperamentally, I am a Theravada, but philosophically, I am a Tibetan Buddhist. Because temperamentally, Buddhism for me is not about Tantra, it's about the Four Noble Truths and the end of suffering. And so I'm perfectly happy in this landscape. But then I am also deeply interested in the all the philosophy that Tibetans got from India. And this is how I was trained. So this is totally idiosyncratic on my part. This is, you know, Tibetans, when they practice Tantra, right? And yeah, so I am here. So this is my own problem. So I have a synthesis of basic Buddhism and Mahayana philosophy. That's basically what Buddhism is for me. Okay, that's the easy question. The second question is the practice of Dzogchen, which is, I mean, there is discussion about the relation of Dzogchen to Tantra, and so Dzogchen is a complex tradition, but there is a basic level of Dzogchen practice, which I think is very, has interesting kind of similarity to what you find maybe in Thailand, in certain Thai practices, which is this idea of, I mean, in Buddhadāsa it's called Chitwang, the empty mind, right? It's the idea of understanding no self, not as an object, but as the nature of the mind. And so you have this meditation, which is introduced in different ways in different Buddhist tradition, about meditating about what they call the nature of the mind, which is to be clear and empty. And so this is what the basis of Dzogchen. Now, Dzogchen goes from there onto very complex practices, which are tantric practices, but the most basic practice in Dzogchen and Mahamudra is to recognize the nature of your mind, right? And so instead of meditating on the, for example, if you think about Vipassana, there is one way to do Vipassana is to meditate on whatever arises. So it's basically meditated on the aggregates, right? How the aggregates constantly change and so on. And so this kind of meditation can lead to a realization of no self as just an absence, right? No self. There is another way to practice meditation, which is not to focus just so much on the skandha, but to focus on the clarity of the mind itself, which is where the aggregates appear, right? And so if you practice like this, which I think some Thai meditators do, then you get to a practice which is relatively similar to Dzogchen, which is this insight of this consciousness which is clear, because things appear to consciousness, but which is also completely empty, right? There is no self, it's just clarity. It's just clarity, and in that clarity, things appear. And that way of meditating, I think, is relatively similar to Dzogchen and Mahamudra. And I think some of the Thai meditation teachers seem to have some practice similar to them, which makes it even more interesting, because there is a tendency in Theravada to enforce a kind of orthodoxy, which I think strikes me as constraining. I will not say more about that. I could become a bit too controversial.
Explain a little bit more. Oh, I'm sorry.
The microphone.
Okay. Sorry. I am listening to the Dorjin. Is it? Could you kindly? Yeah. Explain a little bit more about that, because I don't know about it at all. It is a Tibetan practice.
Yes.
I see.
It's a Tibetan practice favored, developed by the Nyingma tradition of Tibetan Buddhism. It's very similar to another practice, which is called Mahamudra, which is in the Kagyu tradition. The difference is that Mahamudra insists on you doing samatha practice before being introduced to the nature of the mind, whereas Dzogchen, your teacher, will introduce you to the nature of the mind. So it's a kind of mind-to-mind transmission that you receive from a qualified teacher. But the basic insight that you receive is this basic insight that you find in many Buddhist texts, of this idea of consciousness being this clear space in which things arise, but in which there is no center, there is no self, it's completely open, there is no boundary, right? That's the insight that you find in a lot of Buddhist texts, and that's basically the practice of Dzogchen, at least at the first level. Then second level is tantric and quite complicated. And I wouldn't talk about it because I don't know anything very much about it, and that's not what interests me in Buddhism. But Dzogchen is part of what interests me, because I think it's one way to practice meditation, which is a little different from like the Burmese Mahasi Sayadaw method, which is incredibly kind of cutting things in small pieces, and that's a different way to practice. And I think it's I like it personally. Personally, I would think that an idea like Chitwang is connected to that, right? And if you read Luang Mahabua, you find similar ideas, right? So these ideas are quite widespread in Thai Buddhism, though they are not orthodox Theravada ideas. Oops, I shouldn't say that. Yes, sir.
I'm afraid I'm going to embarrass myself, because I don't have a systematic background in Buddhism, really. But can I return to the question of reincarnation?
Yeah.
I'm
probably the wrong person to ask to, but go ahead.
Okay. No, I was going to convert you. No. Okay, there's that old metaphor of bubbles on a stream where individuals or individual selves are merely expressions of one thing. Is that generally correct?
No, that's not the traditional idea of reincarnation. The traditional idea of...
No, I wasn't saying the tradition. I was saying that is one common metaphor.
Okay.
Bubbles on a stream. So
okay.
One bubble bursts and another emerges.
Okay.
And it seems to me that if you're looking at the emotional need for the idea of something like reincarnation,
uh-huh.
it can offer a kind of consolation, because, and it addresses your objection about having an identical self somehow emerge again on some wheel of life. Really, it becomes inconsequential in my own mind. Death then is inconsequential, and there is, within that perspective, the idea that what does it matter? There are going to be other expressions, but it seems to me it also implies a responsibility, because if you lead a good life, then you are improving the conditions for other expressions on that stream to lead a good life. Does that make any sense, or is that utterly naive?
Yes, it does. In all fairness to traditional teaching, they are not saying that you yourself, this, the person I am, my ego is reincarnated. This is not the traditional teaching. For example, I remember the Dalai Lama. We were talking about the lineages of Dalai Lamas, and it's like he was talking about the first to the fifth Dalai Lama, and he told me, he just took my hand like if he was going to tell me something personally. I was his translator, and told me, look, one changed completely character from one reincarnation to the other. And I thought, yeah, why you think this concerns me particularly? It's like as if I was like, I knew him when he was a second Dalai Lama, and I was wondering why he was so different now. That's what he seemed to be saying. So the traditional teaching of Buddhism is not that you go from one life to the other as you are, but that there is a continuity. Now, what the continuity is a subject of enormous debates within the Buddhist tradition, the Indian Buddhist tradition. There are many different versions of that. But this is, nobody says that you yourself as the person you are is going to be reincarnated. In fact, in Tibetan Buddhism, there is a lot of literature about the death process, which describes the complete destruction of who you are. And this is what death means, right? And so then the question is, how do you connect to the next life? And there are many different account. So it's important not to trivialize the traditional account, because I think it's not an account that I would dismiss at all. Your metaphor, I think, is okay. I think it's a good metaphor, because I think, in a way, one way to think about surviving death is helping others, right? Working for others. That's one way we can survive death. And yeah, that's...
I guess my real question was, how naive am I being? But that it seems to me that if you take the perspective of selves being dependent in origin, the extinguisher, the bursting of one bubble does not signify...
I don't think death is such a small thing. It's not so inconsequential. I think for myself personally, I think it's a deep concern. But, that's human condition.
Okay, I was trying to present a position or a perspective where you would still get, not you personally, but people would get a sense of, being able to face death with equanimity, because it doesn't matter, because it persists in the sense, anyway. I'm going out of my depth now. The river stays, and the bubble that dies ideally would, one way or the other, will contribute to that stream.
Which we met. Prapaisan. It's interesting that Prapaisan is developing seminars for Thais to talk about death, and I think that's a good way to try to bring Buddhism into modern Thai culture, because I think death is difficult. Human life is difficult and is dramatic, but it is who we are, and we have to come to terms with it. And I think thinking about one's death is a really great way to free. If your students thought about death, they would not, they would gain some perspective, right, on their life and perspective. And so thinking about death, I think, is actually quite helpful and important. It's one of the first meditation taught in the Lamrim literature, the impermanence of death, because that's a great way to for ourselves to gain some perspective about what we do in life. You know, I was in the BTS like a few days ago. The BTS was stuck, and like we had to all go get out at Ratchathewi station, and the BTS was stuck. Somebody fell on the railway and so on. And I thought, why is the BTS not coming? Why I am wasting all my time? That's really short-sighted, right? Because life is not about that. But often this is what comes from the bottom, right? All these different emotions. And if we don't learn to deal with these emotions rule us, and they lead us to lead pretty unhappy lives. And we want to lead a happy life, right? And that's what Buddhism is supposed to help us to do, right? Whether we are monk, or whether we're nun, or whether we're lay people, I think it can help all of us.
In Tibetan Buddhism, there's a strong emphasis on compassion. Mm-hmm. Compassion is ever present in any teaching, and so it's quite striking actually that it seems that in Thai Buddhism or Theravada, maybe, as far as I can tell, there is very little teaching specifically about karuna. We hear a lot about metta.
Yeah, but metta karuna is the
same. So my question is, like, sometimes I feel like, are we missing out on, because yes, metta karuna, of course, but because metta is really singled out as a word, and I wonder, but this is also maybe a question to other people here.
Yeah.
You know, are we missing out on part of the concept?
Yeah, I think it's there are a lot of things to be said here. First, this is one of the advantages of looking at different Buddhist traditions, is that you can learn different practices. And for example, there are interesting practices about compassion in the Buddhist tradition, in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition, and I think those are valuable, and it would be good if Thai people got to learn these practices, because they are not even only Mahayana. You know, development of compassion is a human quality. It's not Mahayana or Hinayana or Theravada or anything. It's just a human compassion. When I present what Buddhism is about, I always talk about the cultivation of virtues, and for me there are two virtues, non-attachment and compassion. This is what, for me, Buddhism is about. And so compassion, I think, is absolutely integral to Buddhism. Thais talk about metta, but I don't think there are many different, that it's really different from compassion. But there are some teachings in Tibetan Buddhism which are interesting to practice if you want to develop compassion, and which would be good for people to learn about. I think also what there is that with modernity, there is the emphasis on vipassana, which is seen as basically almost the only meditation worth doing, right? And I think that's a real misunderstanding, because if you look at the Buddhist teaching, you have samatha and vipassana, but you also have the four immeasurable, the Brahma Vihara, right? The four residents of Brahma. And those are incredibly important to develop a kind of balanced personality, so that you don't just are mindful, but you're also mindful of the suffering of others, right? And so I think, and now in American Buddhism, in the so-called vipassana tradition, because I don't like the word vipassana, because Tibetan have their own form of vipassana. One time a Buddhist monk, I don't know whether he was probably not Thai, I think Sri Lanka. I was going to Bodh Gaya, it's a long time ago, I was 22, a new monk, to practice some Theravada style meditation. And I learned, it was very good. And the monk was there and he said, oh, that's very good, now you're practicing Vipassana. Tibetans are good, but they only have Samatha. And it's like, no, sorry, you don't know what you're talking about. Vipassana exists in all the Buddhist tradition in different forms. But if Vipassana, which is incredibly important, becomes the only type of practice, I think there is a danger of neglecting some fundamental heart qualities which are really important to a good practice. And I think if you look at the four immeasurable, the four Brahma Vihara, you have a full-blown program of emotional cultivation, right? And I use the Brahma Vihara with my students who are not Buddhist, and I tell them, look, this is things, you know, like sympathetic joy, right? This is a great teaching because we are so envious of other people and that brings us absolutely nothing, right? So why not rejoice about the happiness of other people? That brings us happiness. That's a way we can train our mind and modulate our mind to lead a better life. So I think that aspect of Buddhism is really important. And I think traditionally there was less emphasis on Vipassana and a lot more people cultivated, you know, Brahma Vihara and various practices, right? But with modernity, you have this real emphasis on Vipassana. Now, in American Buddhism, in the so-called Vipassana tradition, they have started to change. At first, they really talked about mindfulness all the time. But now they have introduced a lot of metta and compassion meditation, some taken from Tibetan Buddhism. But the metta meditation in Theravada is really good, and it starts with oneself, and I think especially Westerners, it's really a good meditation to start with oneself and then slowly spread the good wishes.
In Buddhism, is there something called that you have to live up to your higher truth, somewhere like that? Like you have to be compassionate towards other people and you do that through being truthful?
That's not a way Buddhists would talk about that. I mean, you can translate it in Buddhist terms, but I think Buddhism is mostly about developing some of the central virtues like wisdom, detachment, compassion, and so on. That's really what it's about.
Okay. I just see if you see some, let's say, some problems in society where people are misguided and you would like to show them the way to be more compassionate, do you think you would have a...
Where would I start from? Okay. I mean, you know, it's just like, yeah. New Age never made sense to me because the idea that the world is moving toward... What's the age of Aquarius? Or, right? Yeah, that's way of thinking, you know, this is going to transform the world. No. Human history is tragic. And, you know, we live a short life and we try to do the best we can. And I don't think there is much hope of us having this great awakening for the world, the entire world, and so on. Right now, I think our main preoccupation should be not to destroy completely this world, right? If we can do that, we already done something pretty good. But for me personally, I never see Buddhism as a solution to all the problems. It's a way for me to deal with the problems that I face as a human being. And, you know, there are other things as well. Buddhism is not the only interesting tradition in this world, right? There are other ways of thinking. But Buddhism is, for me, the way to deal with my own life, with suffering. Thank you for organizing this. It's a great privilege to be in Suan Mok, and I am very happy to connect with people here. And I am really happy.